The intrinsic muscle of the hands. Are short muscles whose origin and insertion are all confined within the hand. There are altogether 20 such intrinsic muscles. They are the thenar muscles, 3 plus adductor pollicis. Number 2, hypothenar muscles, again 3 plus palmaris brevis. Next, 4 lumbricals, 4 palmar interossei. Four dorsal interossei, all together 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 20, and all these muscles are responsible for skilled movement of the hand. They all have small motor unit carrying out precision work, and they are discussed later on. The skeleton of hand includes 5 metacarpal bones numbered 1 to 5 from lateral to medial. We are seeing the palmar and dorsal view of the skeleton of the hand. The side of the thumb is the lateral side, and that of the little finger is medial side. Metacarpals are numbered from lateral to medial, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Each of the metacarpal is a miniature long bone. And consist of 3 part: head, on the distal end, base, on the proximal end, and in between the head and base lies the shaft of the metacarpal. In between the 5 metacarpals lies the 4 intermetacarpal spaces, and occupying those intermetacarpal spaces are muscles which are called interossei. There are 2 sets of interossei. One, the palmar interossei, which are located between the palmar surface of the metacarpals and numbered 1 to 4 from lateral to medial. So palmar interossei are 4 in number. Similarly, there are 4 dorsal interossei as well, which are also numbered from lateral to medial, 1 to 4 from lateral to medial, and located deep to the palmar interossei, more towards the dorsal aspect of the palm. So dorsal interossei are better viewed on dorsal view of the hand. So palmar interossei more on the palmar side, dorsal interossei more on the dorsal side. If I take a cross sectional view through the middle of the palm, this is the palmar aspect, this is the dorsal aspect, lateral side and medial side. The four palmar interossei, 1, 2, 3, and 4, from lateral to medial, they are located between the palmar surface of metacarpals. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Regarding the dorsal interossei, each of the dorsal interossei are located deep to the palmar interossei, more on the dorsal aspect of the hand. So we get four dorsal interossei: first, second, third and fourth. So the orientation is palmar interossei superficial to the dorsal interossei, or dorsal interossei are deep to the palmar interossei. With that said, let's move on to the individual palmar interossei. The first diagram depicts the palmar interossei. And this is the palmar view of the skeleton. The second diagram depicts the dorsal interossei. And the view is the same, that is also the palmar view. That means in the second diagram, in order to visualize the dorsal interossei, the palmar interossei or the superficial overlying muscles have been removed. Let's move on to the palmar interossei. There are four palmar interossei, lateral to medial. They are numbered 1, 2, 3, and 4 respectively, located between the palmar surface of the metacarpals. Regarding the origin of the palmar interossei, the first palmar interosseus is originated from the medial side of the base of first metacarpal and inserted into the medial side of the base of proximal phalanx of thumb. Regarding the second palmar interossei, it is originated from the medial half of the palmar aspect of the shaft of second metacarpal. So, the second palmar interosseus originates from the medial half of palmar aspect of shaft. That is important. Regarding the first palmar interosseous, it was from the medial side of the base, but the second one from the medial side of the palmar surface of shaft. Okay, so the second palmar interosseous originates from the medial half of the palmar aspect of shaft of second metacarpal, and it passes distally to get inserted into the medial side of base of proximal phalanx of index finger. This is a proximal phalanx. Moving on to the third and fourth palmar interosseous. The third palmar interosseous, it originates from the lateral part of palmar surface of the shaft of fourth metacarpal and is inserted into the lateral side of base of proximal phalanx of ring finger. And the fourth palmar interosseous, it originates from the lateral part of palmar surface of shaft of fifth metacarpal and passes distally and inserted into the lateral side of base of proximal phalanx of little finger. So that is about the origin and insertion of the palmar interosseous muscle. 1, 2, 3, 4. All these palmar interosseous are unipennate. The fibers are going along a single direction. Moving on to the dorsal interosseus, seen from the palmar view. After removal of the palmar interosseus and dip to them, there are four dorsal interosseus. Regarding the origin and insertion of the first dorsal interosseus. The first one, the first dorsal interosseus, originates from the adjacent side of the shaft of the first and second metacarpal bone, that is about the first dorsal interosseus, and it is inserted onto the lateral side of the base of proximal phalanx of index finger. That is the insertion. Next, moving on to the second dorsal interosseus, it is originating from the adjacent side of the shaft of second and third metacarpal bone and is inserted into the lateral side of the base of proximal phalanx of middle finger. As regards the third dorsal interosseous, it originates from adjacent side of the shaft of third and fourth metacarpals and are inserted into the medial side of the base of proximal phalanx of middle finger. Coming on to the fourth dorsal interosseous, it is originating from the adjacent side of the shaft of fourth and fifth metacarpal bone and is inserted into the medial side of base of proximal phalanx of ring finger. So these are the origin and insertion of the dorsal interossei. In contrast to the palmar interossei, the dorsal interossei, each of them are bipinnate. The muscle fiber direction in each of the dorsal interossei are actually from both the sides. So it is bipinnate. What are the nerve supply of this palmar and dorsal interossei? What about them? All the palmar and dorsal interossei are supplied by the deep branch of ulnar nerve. Actually, all the intrinsic muscle of the hand except the thenar muscle and first and second lumbricals and the palmaris brevis are supplied by the deep branch of ulnar nerve. Regarding the function, the palmar interossei are the adductors. The mnemonic is PAD, palmar interossei are adductors. Adductor means they push the other fingers towards the central axis of the hand, which passes through the third metacarpal and the middle finger. Central axis. Whereas the dorsal interossei doing the opposite of the palmar interossei, they are the abductors. So the mnemonic is DAB. They are help the fingers to spread apart with reference to the same central axis. So palmar interossei are adductors and dorsal interossei abductors. PAD and DAB. How to clinically test the intactness of the palmar and dorsal interossei? In order to test the palmar interossei, the patient is asked to grasp the paper between the two adjacent fingers. If the muscles are healthy and acting properly, the paper will be firmly held between the fingers and some resistance is offered when the clinician tries to withdraw the paper. So that is the test for the palmar interossei, the adductor function. Whereas, to test the dorsal interossei, the patient is asked to spread apart the fingers against resistance which is provided by the clinician. If the dorsal interossei are intact and healthy, then the abductor function of the patient will be executed fine, even against the resistance. So that is the way the palmar and dorsal interossei are clinically tested. Now we are going to tell you the difference between the palmar and dorsal interossei in a few words. Palmar interossei, dorsal interossei. We know the palmar interossei are situated on the palmar surface between the metacarpals, whereas dorsal interossei are situated beneath the palmar interossei in a deeper plane, more onto the dorsal aspect. Palmar interossei are unipennate. Dorsal interossei are bipennate. Origin and insertion, I am not repeating. Regarding action, the palmar interossei are adductors. Dorsal interossei are abductors. So that is the chief difference between the palmar and the dorsal interossei. Thenar muscle are 3 in number. They are abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, and opponent's pollicis. As regards the relationship and orientation, the thenar muscle form the thenar eminence a bulge at the root of the thumb over on the palm. A similar eminence is also seen on the other side of the palm at the root of little finger, is known as hypothenar eminence. And just like the thenar eminence is made up of 3 thenar muscles, the hypothenar eminence is in turn made up of 3 hypothenar muscles. The abductor pollicis brevis lies laterally. Flexor pollicis brevis lies medially. And the opponent's pollicis lies deep between them. So in order to see the opponent's pollicis, we have to cut through the abductor pollicis brevis and flexor pollicis brevis. This is the cut section of abductor pollicis brevis, and this is the cut section of the flexor pollicis brevis. Beneath the covering of 2 muscles, we get to see the belly of the opponent's pollicis. Together, these three muscles, abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, and opponens pollicis, constitute the thenar group of muscle, which form the thenar eminence on the palmar aspect of root of the thumb. Let's discuss the origin and insertion of the thenar group of muscles. The skeleton of hand in this diagram is seen in palmar view. The carpal bones are arranged in two rows. In the proximal row, there is scaphoid, lunate, triquetral, and pisiform from lateral to medial side. And on the distal row, from lateral to medial side, we get trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. So, the two row of carpal bones, totaling in 8 in number, form the carpus region of the hand. The pisiform, which is a sesamoid bone, is seen to be sitting on the proximal row of carpal bone on the triquetral. Now, regarding the origin of the abductor pollicis brevis, on the scaphoid bone, there is a prominence on its lateral side that is called tubercle of scaphoid over here. Similarly, a bony ridge or crest of trapezium is seen on the trapezium bone like this. The origin of abductor pollicis brevis is from tubercle of scaphoid and the crest of trapezium. Scaphoid, crest of trapezium. So, that is the origin of the abductor pollicis brevis, tubercle of scaphoid and crest of trapezium. So, we put a mark over the origin of the abductor pollicis brevis. Regarding its insertion, it is inserted into the lateral side of the base of proximal phalanx of thumb. Let's see the course of the muscle and it will be clear. Look, as I have already told you, that abductor pollicis brevis is originated from tubercle of scaphoid and crest of trapezium. Here is the scaphoid, here is the trapezium. And it is inserted into the radial side or lateral side of base of proximal phalanx of thumb. So the tracing of the muscle is like this. The crest of trapezium, once again, is this. This is the trapezium. And the tubercle of scaphoid is over here. We know that the deep fascia in front of the carpal bones is called the flexor retinaculum, and it is attached. The flexor retinaculum is attached both on the tubercle of scaphoid and crest of trapezium on the lateral side, and on medial side it is attached on the hook of Hammett and the pisiform bone. That is the flexor retinaculum or deep fascia in front of the carpal bones on the palmar aspect. Now let's clear out these diagrams. The flexor pollicis brevis has a superficial head and deep head. The deep head originates from the trapezoid and capitate. This is capitate, this is trapezoid. So the deep head is originating from the trapezoid and capitate bone. Whereas the superficial head, originates from the crest of trapezium and the distal border of flexor retinaculum. So the deep head is first from trapezoid and capitate. Regarding the superficial head, first draw the flexor retinaculum once again. The superficial head originates from the distal border of flexor retinaculum and from the crest of trapezium. The crest of trapezium is like this. There is a flexor retinaculum. So the origin of the superficial head of the flexor pollicis brevis can be put up on the distal border of the flexor retinaculum. There is the distal border. Of flexor retinaculum. And this is the crest of trapezium. Regarding its insertion, let's join the superficial and deep head. And join them together. And both of them are ultimately inserted over at this point. That is the lateral side of the base of proximal phalanx of thumb. Next is the origin and insertion of opponent's pollicis. Opponent's pollicis originates from the flexor retinaculum and crest of trapezium. So let's put the opponent's pollicis origin. This is the origin of opponent's pollicis. This is the flexor retinaculum in green bands. And you know by this time the location of the crest of trapezium. This is the trapezium. This is the scaphoid. This is the trapezoid. capitate. So opponent's pollicis is getting its origin from over here, from the flexor retinaculum and crest of trapezium. And it is passing distally to be inserted along the lateral border and adjoining lateral half of the palmar surface of the shaft of first metacarpal. So the insertion of opponent's pollicis is along the lateral half of the palmar surface of first metacarpal. Okay. Coming to the action of the individual thenar group of muscles, as the name suggests, abductor pollicis longus causes abduction of the thumb, abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, it causes flexion of thumb, and opponent's pollicis, it is causing opposition of thumb. We are now going to discuss about the different movements of the thumb. What is abduction and adduction of the thumb? What is flexion extension of the thumb? And what is opposition movement of the thumb? For a better understanding of the function of the thenar muscles. Regarding the nerve supply, all the intrinsic muscles of the hand are supplied by the ulnar nerve except the three thenar muscles and first and second lumbricals. They are supplied by the median nerve. So, nerve supply of the thenar muscle is by median nerve. To be more specific, it is the recurrent branch of median nerve which supply the thenar muscles. Basically, what happens is that the median nerve, look at the diagram, is passing underneath the flexor retinaculum like this. Suppose the median nerve, it is going below the flexor retinaculum, and after coming out from below the flexor retinaculum, it is divided into a lateral division and a medial division. And the lateral division, gives out a recurrent branch, the branch which curves over himself. It is curving backwards, coming out from the lateral branch, and that is called the recurrent branch of median nerve, and it is supplying the thenar group of muscles. Median nerve. Hypothenar muscles are also three in number and form the hypothenar eminence. At the root of little finger. The three muscles that form the hypothenar eminence are called the hypothenar muscles. They are as follows: abductor digiti minimi, lying most medially. This is the medial side, this is the lateral side. Then lateral to it is the flexor digiti minimi. And opponent's digiti minimi lies deep to the above two muscles. So when both the muscles have been cut, we get to see the opponent's digiti minimi. So where is the opponent's digiti minimi? It is not seen in the picture clearly. The outline of the opponent's digiti minimi is here. This is the outline of the opponent's digiti minimi. Shifting off to the picture on the left side, the abductor digiti minimi has been cut, exposing the flexor digiti minimi, lateral to it, and deep to the flexor digiti minimi, peeping beneath it. Is the opponent's digiti minimi. Okay, flexor digiti minimi, opponent's digiti minimi, abductor digiti minimi. All these muscles, all these hypothenar muscles are supplied by the deep branch of ulnar nerve. One thing that I must mention again and again, that all the intrinsic muscles of the hand are supplied by deep branch of ulnar nerve. Look, the ulnar nerve and median nerve, two are entering the palm. The ulnar nerve has a superficial group and a deep branch. Superficial branch and the deep branch. The deep branch supplies all the intrinsic muscles except few of them, which are supplied by median nerve. These are the thenar muscles, three of them, and first and second lumbrical. Whereas the superficial branch of ulnar nerve supplies a muscle, palmaris brevis, which is also an intrinsic muscle of the hand. So apart from the palmaris brevis, three thenar muscle and first and second lumbrical, all the other muscles are supplied by deep branch of ulnar nerve. That is what I was trying to say. Okay. So hypothenar muscles are obviously supplied by the deep branch of ulnar nerve. Next, going on to the origin and precise insertion of the hypothenar group of muscles. Let's take a look at them. The carpal group of bones are 8 in number and they are arranged in proximal and distal row. Okay. On the palmar view, from the lateral to medial side, the proximal row of muscles are scaphoid, lunate, trichoatrial, and overlying the trichoatrial is a round bone, that is a sesamoid bone. Sesamoid means that is developed in the tendon of a muscle, that is the pisiform bone. And overlying all these proximal group of the carpal bones are the distal group of carpal bones, and they are from lateral to medial. Most lateral is the trapezium, then the trapezoid, next is the largest carpal bone, capitate, and next to it is the hamate. We will concentrate onto the pisiforman hamate. The hamate has a hook-like process. It is called hook of hamate. The pisiform and a hook of hamate, both of them give attachment to the deep fascia in front of the carpal bones, which is called flexor retinaculum. Flexor retinaculum, having a quadrangular shape, is lying in front of the carpal bones and attached medially to the pisiform bone and hook of hamate. From these three structures, pisiform, flexor retinaculum, the medial end, and the hook of hamate, all the hypothenar muscles are taking their origin. Regarding the abductor digiti minimi, it is originating from the pisiform bone itself. Now, pisiform bone is a sesamoid bone, and sesamoid bone means it is actually developing in the tendon of another muscle, and that tendon is tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. Now, attached to the pisiform bone and the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris is the origin of abductor digiti minimi. So the origin of abductor digiti minimi is from the flexor carpi ulnaris tendon and the pisiform bone. And after its origin, it is like passing laterally and distally, and it is inserted over here. That is the ulnar side of the base of proximal phalanx of little finger. So that is about the origin and insertion of the abductor digiti minimi. Next we shift on to the rest of the two hypothenar muscle, that is the flexor digiti minimi and opponens digiti minimi. Both the flexor digiti minimi and the opponens digiti minimi, they are originating from the hook of hamate and flexor retinaculum. The origin of the flexor digiti minimi is from the hook of hamate and flexor retinaculum, and it is inserted along with the abductor digiti minimi to the ulnar side of the base of proximal phalanx of little finger. That is the flexor digiti minimi. And last but not the least, the opponens digiti minimi It is also originating from the hook of Hammett and the flexor retinaculum and is inserted over onto the medial surface of the shaft of fifth metacarpal. Onto the medial surface of the shaft of the fifth metacarpal. That is the insertion of opponens digiti minimi. Regarding their function, the abductor digiti minimi function is abduction of little finger. Flexor digiti minimi, flexion of little finger, and opponens digiti minimi, that is the opposition of the tip of little finger. We'll discuss the different movements of the thumb and the other fingers to get a better understanding of that topic. Adductor pollicis muscle. Is located deep in the palm, deep to the thenar muscle, and in contact with the metacarpals and interossei. It can be seen when the thenar muscles are cut. There is a cut section of the thenar muscle, and the outline of the adductor pollicis is as follows. It has got a transverse head. There is a transverse head and an oblique head. And both of them converge laterally to be inserted into the thumb. So adductor pollicis is basically a fan shaped muscle. That is lying on a deeper plane of that of the thenar muscles. So in between the thenars and the interossei and lumbricals, the adductor pollicis is situated. Okay. Next have a look on the origin and insertion of the adductor pollicis muscle. The oblique head arises from the anterior aspect of capitate bone and the base of second and third metacarpal bones. This is the second metacarpal, third metacarpal. So from the capitate and the base of second and third metacarpal, the oblique head is arising. Forming a crescentic shape, whereas the transverse head arises from the anterior surface or palmar surface of the shaft of third metacarpal. That is the transverse head. Palmar surface of the shaft of first metacarpal. Now, both the heads ultimately converge. So we can draw both the heads like this. This is the oblique head. The muscle fibers are converging towards the medial side of the base of proximal phalanx of thumb, whereas the transverse head, which is originating from the palmar surface of the shaft of third metacarpal, its fibers are also converging for insertion to the medial side of the base of proximal phalanx. Okay. So both the oblique heads and transverse head are converged together to be inserted over the medial side of base of proximal phalanx of the thumb. So that is the insertion. Nerve supply, you know, except for the thenar muscles, first and second lumbricals and palmaris brevis, all the muscles are supplied by the deep branch of ulnar nerve. So adductor pollicis is supplied by the deep branch of ulnar nerve. And regarding the action, as the name suggests, adduction of the thumb. Adduction of the thumb. Now there is one important thing, that the tendons of insertion of adductor pollicis on the medial side of the base of proximal phalanx of thumb over here contain a sesamoid bone. So sesamoid bone may be present over at the site of tendon of insertion of adductor pollicis. In between the oblique head and transverse head, the deep palmar arch and the deep branch of ulnar nerve pass. So the deep palmar arch, an arterial U-shaped arterial segment, and the deep branch of ulnar nerve there is a deep palmar arch and it is the deep branch of ulnar nerve. Passes in between the two heads of the adductor pollicis. These two structures. Now let's move on to discuss the movements of the thumb. How the thumb is moved in different planes, to get a better understanding of the function of the thenar and the hypothenar muscles. Okay. The various movements of thumb is flexion, extension, adduction, abduction, opposition, and a combination of all of them, that is the circumduction. Regarding the flexion and extension, the flexion and extension occur in the plane of the palm. This is the flexion. This is the extension. Occurring at the plane of the palm. This is the plane of the palm. So it is occurring in the plane of the palm. Whereas in case of abduction and adduction, they occur at right angle to the plane of the palm. So in case of abduction and adduction, they are occurring at right angle to the plane of the palm. In abduction, the thumb is going distal to the palm or away from the palm, and in adduction, the reverse occur, the thumb is coming close to the palm. And what is opposition? Opposition is the finger counting movement. When you count numbers, it occurs across the palm in such a manner that the tip of the thumb, the anterior surface of the tip of the thumb, comes into contact with the anterior surface of tips of other fingers. So the tip of the thumb is coming into contact with the anterior surface of tip of other finger. Tips coming in contact. That is the opposition movement. Flexion of the thumb is brought about by flexor pollicis longus and flexor pollicis brevis. So the flexor pollicis brevis is a thinner muscle which is bringing about the flexion of the thumb. Similarly, extension is brought about by extensor pollicis longus and extensor pollicis brevis. Adduction is by adductor pollicis. Abduction by abductor pollicis longus, abductor pollicis brevis. Abductor pollicis brevis is a what? It is a thinner muscle. Okay. Opposition is done by opponent's pollicis. So the abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis and opponent's pollicis, they are serving the function as their name indicates. That is the abduction, flexion and opposition of the thumb respectively. The long flexor tendon of the digits refers to those tendon which run up to the finger and help in their flexion. The long flexor tendon of the thumb refers to the tendon of flexor pollicis longus. But for the rest of the medial four fingers, that is to say for index, middle, ring and little finger, there are two sets of flexor tendons. One belong to the flexor digitorum superficialis and the other belong to the flexor digitorum profundus. The flexor digitorum superficialis tendons lie, as their name suggests, at a superficial plane. And they are ultimately inserted into the side of the middle phalanx of the corresponding digit. So these are the tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis. Deep to the flexor digitorum superficialis lies the tendon of flexor digitorum profundus, and they become evident only when the tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis are cut, which has been done in the current view. After cutting the flexor digitorum superficialis, the flexor digitorum profundus are seen underneath them. So these are the tendons of the flexor digitorum profundus beneath the tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis. There are four such tendons, numbered lateral to medial side. The lumbrical muscles, which is the topic, they are very short and elongated worm-like muscle and four in number. This lumbrical muscle, they originate from the tendons of this flexor digitorum profundus. So from the tendon of FDP, the lumbrical muscles are getting their origin. So let's see. The lumbricals are four muscles which are numbered 1, 2, 3 and 4 from lateral to medial side. This is the outline of first lumbrical. Then the second. Third one. And fourth one. This lumbrical muscle is a small slender muscle and they are one for each medial foot digit. They are known as lumbricals because of their elongated worm-like shape. Latin lumbrical mean earthworm. Lumbrical 1 and 2 originate from the lateral side of the lateral two tendons of flexor digitorum profundus. Lateral side of the lateral two tendons of flexor digitorum profundus. That is the origin of the lumbrical 1 and 2. So 1 and 2 are originating from the lateral side of first and second FDP tendons. Whether for the lumbrical 3 and 4, they originate from the adjacent side of the medial three tendons of the flexor digitorum profundus. So 3 and 4 originates from the adjacent side of second third and fourth tendon of flexor digitorum profundus. This is the second FDP tendon. This is the third. And this one is the fourth one. The third and fourth lumbricals are arising from the adjacent side of the second, third and fourth FDP. That means the third lumbrical arises from the tendon of second flexor digitorum profundus and third flexor digitorum profundus. Similarly, the fourth lumbrical, it originates from the tendon of third and fourth flexor digitorum profundus. This diagram has been simplified over here, where the tendon of flexor pollicis longus and flexor digitorum profundus has been depicted. This is the first, second, third and fourth. The first lumbrical is originating from the lateral side of the first tendon. second lumbrical from the lateral side of second, third one from the adjacent side of second and third FDP tendons, and fourth one from the adjacent side of third and fourth FDP tendons. And as you can see, the first and second lumbricals are unipinnate. But in case of third and fourth, these lumbricals are bipinnate. Now, as regards their insertion, the lumbricals cross the radial side of metacarpophalangeal joint. Let's draw the metacarpal underneath metacarpal bone. This is the metacarpal bone. This is the distal phalanx. Proximal phalanx. This is the metacarpal. So the lumbrical tendons are basically crossing the radial side of the metacarpophalangeal joint, and they are passing laterally and dorsally towards the back. Obviously, this is the palmar view of the hand. The lumbricals, after being originated from the palmar aspect, they are going backward and dorsally, and they are inserted into the dorsal digital expansion. Of the corresponding digit. And we'll discuss the dorsal digital expansion later to get a better understanding. Regarding the nerve supply, the first and second lumbricals are supplied by median nerve, and third and fourth lumbricals, they are supplied by deep branch of ulnar nerve. The lumbricals, regarding their action, the lumbricals flexes the metacarpophalangeal joint and extend the proximal and distal interphalangeal joint. Flexes the metacarpophalangeal joint and extends the proximal interphalangeal and distal interphalangeal joints. So the result of lumbrical function is the flexion of metacarpophalangeal joint. And extension of proximal interphalangeal joint, extension, and distal interphalangeal joint extension. So the palm along with the extended finger looks like the letter inverted L. That is the function of the lumbrical. Lumbricals. Palmaris brevis. Is a intrinsic muscle of the hand, and that is a subcutaneous muscle. That means on lifting of the skin, we get to see the quadrangular muscle. This is the palmaris brevis. It originates from the medial margin of the deep fossa of the palm, that is the palmar aponeurosis, as well as from the deep fossa in front of the carpal bones, that is known as the flexor retinaculum. So flexor retinaculum and the palmar aponeurosis, the medial margin of palmar aponeurosis, are the origin of the muscle, whereas insertion is onto the skin on the medial border of hand. Palmaris brevis is supplied by the superficial branch of ulnar nerve, and action is when an object is grasped tightly in the hand, it causes wrinkling on the medial palmar skin and helps to prevent the ulnar displacement of the hypothenar eminence. Basically, it improves the grip. The palmaris brevis, being a subcut muscle, it belongs to the subcutaneous group of muscle which are called panniculus carnosus. What is the name? Panniculus carnosus. There are other panniculus carnosus or subcutaneous muscles in the body, just like palmaris brevis. Example, dartos muscle of scrotum, platysma of neck, etc. So palmaris brevis, a subcutaneous muscle in the superficial fascia of the medial part of palm, forms one of the intrinsic muscles supplied by the superficial branch of ulnar nerve.